Amy Adams, our next guest. In a surprise move, two National MPs announced they're stepping down yesterday. One of those senior MPs and Nationals finance spokesperson, Amy Adams. She'll stay on until next year's election, so by-elections in her very, very comfortably held huge majority electorate of Selwyn won't be necessary. Good morning, smiling
Good
beside
morning, John.
Me. We're joined now by Amy Adams to discuss her political career and the decision to leave Parliament. You look actually like a woman who's had a weight lifted off her shoulders. I'm not just saying that because it's an obvious. I mean, you do look kind of like metaphysically kind of lighter. Why?
Do
you feel, why?
Well, partly, I guess, because I made the decision a couple of months back. So keeping it, you know, inside until we'd made the decision that the time was right to announce has been a challenge. But also it's just that liberating feeling of thinking, gee, I get to get my life back. I get to be a normal person and maybe claim back a little bit of privacy. And that's kind of exciting.
Right. I want to talk about how brutalising politics can be. But I also want to talk about the sort of conjecture and speculation, mostly in my mind, about the other reasons that you might be leaving. So what order do you want to do it in? Should we do brutalising first?
You can do whatever you like, okay. But I can assure you there's no scandal.
It's not scandal. It's just that you are enormously popular in Selwyn.
Thank you.
Even an election you didn't win, you got, what was it, almost 65 or 70% of the vote, right? Mm. And that's an election National lost. Mm. You have a huge majority, so you're there for good. You are a crossover politician. You can do both the urban and country rural environments. Mm. You are a relatively liberal by our national standards. You voted for marriage equality, unlike your leader, who is a little bit at odds with liberal urban New Zealand. And I just wonder, given how much you have to offer, why the hell are you leaving? And the reason that keeps popping up in my head is that you don't see a particularly galvanised or exciting future under the current leadership.
No, it really isn't that. And I know that people are going to sort of speculate on that. It's honestly about the decisions I've made for me and my future. I've always kind of had a view of politics that there's perhaps two types. They're the career politicians, and then there's the get in, give it everything, and then go off and do something else brigade. And I've always seen myself in the latter camp. There's this view that people get into politics and then it's such a cushy life, they stay there as long as they possibly can. The reality is it's hard. You know, John, you've been around the gallery and you've been around Parliament. It's a hard life, long hours, punishing schedule, no privacy, your family misses out, you're constantly in the public eye. You get to do amazing things, and I love the job, but it takes a toll. And I've always thought, the day I thought that the life was taking more out of me than I could give, then that was the time to step aside. So I've been incredibly privileged, loved it, but I don't want to hang around and take up space. Let someone else come through with some new energy and ideas, and I think that's how you get a healthy democracy.
What's the thing you've loved the most?
Wow, the thing I've loved the most, I love working on things that make, and it sounds cheesy, I know, but make New Zealand better. So the work I did in family and sexual violence, I feel so proud of. It's an unfinished piece of work. There's still far more to do, but I'm so proud of having made a difference in that space. I'm so proud of the work we did to create the expungement regime for historical homosexual offences. I'm incredibly proud of getting better internet connectivity around this country. I think that's transformative. I'm proud of work I've done locally in my electorate, and I won't bore you with all the local projects, but getting to think you've made a difference is it's pretty heady and a very special feeling.
I'm not going to push you on this because you have the right to not answer this question, given that you have decided to leave. But I want, do you have faith in the current National Party leadership? And I guess let's not be coy about it. I'm talking about Simon Bridges, to be a reflection of the kind of 21st century things that you were just describing in part. Is he the modern face of the National Party that the National Party needs to lead them back into government, given that by and large the floating voters in this country live in our cities and are probably more liberal than Simon Bridges?
Yeah, I think there's a couple of things in that. First of all, I think Simon is absolutely the right leader to take us into the election. He's had my 100% support from the day that I lost in the leadership contest to him. He's been a mate all the way through that, and I think he's a good leader. But the other point to what you're saying, John, is that you're right. There is a range of views in National, as there is in the country. Mm. I'm on the more socially liberal end of the spectrum. Simon's perhaps slightly on the more conservative side. New Zealand is that mix. The National Party's that mix. And one of the things I love about our party is that it embraces both sets of views. We've certainly got very strong Liberal caucus, and we've got some more Conservative. If we can marry those two sides, then actually I think that's pretty reflective of New Zealand.
I go back to the leadership contest, and you were aspirational, you were energetic, and you were absolutely up for it. Now, when was that? The beginning of last year.
Yeah.
So what's changed since?
Actually, the funny thing of what's changed is I've always believed don't die wondering, right? So I had a group of MPs who wanted me to put myself forward, and I wanted to kind of, I guess, make that option available to the party.
Some they of the youngsters, like Nikki Kaye and Chris Bishop, came out and backed you, didn't they?
Yeah, they did. I had a good range of support in the party. But the great thing about losing is that I now have the freedom to reflect a bit on what I want and what's right for me. If the party had chosen me, of course, I would have committed myself to leading them to the best of my ability for as long as they wanted. But the good thing about losing is that I now have the freedom to choose about the life I want. And I've enjoyed the finance role immensely. But thinking about could I re-up for another 3 years just got me reflecting that actually there's things I'd like to do now.
One final question, and I'm so sorry to ask it because I need the answer to be short.
Okay.
But what would make life easier for politicians? How can it become less brutalising? How can it take less of a toll on the people who enter politics?
I don't know that I have a simple or a short answer, John. What I think, perhaps it was just a little bit more understanding of the public, of the realities of the job. I think perhaps they perceive us as all fat and lazy and good for nothing and there for the wrong reasons. And the hatred and vitriol that comes with that is wearing. Perhaps if there was a little bit more understanding of the reality of the jobs we do and the reasons we do them, maybe that would help.
Amy Adams, we really appreciate you joining us this morning. Thank you so much for your time, and we look forward to talking to you again between now and your departure next election.